among the Afghans, we have an activist who, like a soldier, also fights battles. We have a scholar, and we have a journalist who works for the BBC. And we have all your questions. We're going to start. You know, it's very difficult in civilian life to decide on ranking, but in the military, it's very clear. It's so easy. I think we only have one general in the group.
Thank you, Lyse.
That's why you're joining. Let me just first of all tell you, General David Richards, you may know him well, he has worked in a lot of the world's trouble spots, from Northern Ireland to East Timor to Sierra Leone and to Afghanistan, where he was the commander of the International Security Assistance Forces 2006 and 7, also described as very critical leaders. He's now the Chief of General Staff for the British Army. He has spoken of a British involvement that will have to be long and deep. And I think I can say that General Richard's involvement will also be long indeed. Francesc Vendrell has a diplomatic career spanning 40 years, or is it four? Right across the globe. He was the UN envoy to Afghanistan when the Taliban was in power, and then he became the EU envoy from 2002 to 2008. Of interest to this audience, of interest to this country, he was recently made, and I have to I'm also a foreigner, I have to read it, a commander of the Order of St. Michael and St. George, a CMG. No, that's not right?
Yeah, it's a companion, not commander. No, military.
Sitting next to him is Ahmed Rashid, also well known to all of us, a leading author of four books on Afghanistan and the region. The most recent is Descent into Chaos, although he tells us it wasn't a bit of horoscope that he was doing in Afghanistan. Also, he wrote the best-selling and very important book on the Taliban. Those two books now are on the reading list of 20 universities, and I can say it's on the desk of many top commanders and people working in Afghanistan. Many of you may have read the books as well. He also, when his book, The Taliban, hit the best-seller list when the Taliban were toppled in 2001, made sure that a third of the funds from his book went to set up an open media fund for Afghanistan. I'm very grateful for all that. Finally, David Page, who I know well because for 20 years, he achieved something that Richard Holbrooke would love to achieve. He was in charge of something called Indo-AFPAC. He was the chair of all the dispatches from India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. Now, of course, it's just AFPAC or PACAP. He has been on the Board of Trustees of Afghanaid since 1996. He's been the chair of the trustees since 2003. He also is a member of a media project for South Asia. We will hear from the Afghans in a moment, and first to you, General Richards.
Well, thank you very much, Lyse. And first of all, let me thank Afghanaid. Is that right? For organising tonight. And more widely, having spent best part of a year there, admiring what they do for all you do in Afghanistan for the people there. And while we might all have different views about how to go about it, I hope everyone here tonight, certainly everyone on the panel, is united in one determination, which is that we must do all we can to help the people of Afghanistan. I should concede, first of all, having spent nearly a year there, that Afghanistan and its people have entered my bloodstream, as is the case for so many foreigners who live there. The scenery is stunning, from the mountains of the Hindu Kush to the north to the deserts of Kandahar in the south. But of course it is the people with what I've described, and I've got to remind myself what I did call it, with their exotic blend of great kindness, which is certainly the case, through to terrifying savagery and everything else in between that makes Afghanistan so fascinating, almost intoxicating, and I probably did get rather drunk on it actually, to the outsider. It's a place that historically has lured adventurer and intellectual alike and misunderstood has been the cause of many a great nation's military catastrophe. And I think understanding the place and its people has been, to a degree and still is, our Achilles heel. Don't forget that these people, in and since inflicting the last of those defeats on the Soviet Union, have been through hell and back over two complete generations. This, one could say, their reward for a key role in the collapse of communism and the liberation of millions of people in Eastern Europe, something for which they got precious little credit then or since. Now, time's against me, rightly, but just a few facts. The Taliban, who range from hardline militant Islamists through to drug barons and alienated tribal chiefs, compose a very small part of the population, probably around 5% at most, and they're all from one ethnic group. I spoke to a tribal leader today, funnily enough, quite coincidentally, he came to see me for an hour, who confirmed that in his valley there were 30 Talibs terrorizing and terrifying the 200,000 people who live in that valley who want nothing to do with them. They are not some Che Guevara-like band of freedom fighters. Their leaders are ruthless fanatics who will stoop to anything, and I mean anything, in the pursuit of power, readily killing by design children and women in order to terrorize communities into submission. And I do, as the head of the British Army, always resile against those who compare us in any way whatsoever. Not one of my soldiers goes to Afghanistan intending to kill one child. Our opponents, while not necessarily going out to do it, know full well that the tactics they employ could well lead to that dreadful result. And I think, you know, putting us into the same pot is something I'd ask you not to do. Many are sceptical that we can succeed. I'm an optimist, and I'd just like to tell you why. Just to remind you that only 18 months ago, many of us in this room, and maybe I was one of them, felt that Iraq was about to implode. It was a disaster. We'd written it off. Yet today, most of us are cautiously optimistic. We knew the ingredients for success, but it took us time to discover the correct formula. How do you mix and match those ingredients? Including, I would say this, wouldn't I, including the crucial importance of putting enough boots on the ground, as it's come to be known, to achieve the enduring security effect we all know is so important if we're to meet all those other things, which I'm sure we're going to talk about tonight. But the number of times Afghans have said to me, don't worry too much about the schools and even the jobs, although I personally feel that's vital. What we really want from the West is security and being allowed to get on and live our own lives in the way we know best. And of course, I'm the first to acknowledge they know a lot better than me about how to live their lives. Sadly, not everyone, well-intentioned they might be,